Believe with the words of the ancient Apostles' Creed found in your bulletin. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Before you're seated, if you'll turn and those around you, welcome this place this morning. And it is truly good to welcome you to this service of worship this morning and to the fellowship of this congregation. It is good to have you with us during this time. We especially want to welcome those of you who may be visiting with us as first-time guests. And if you are a first-time guest, we do have an information table about the life of our church in the hallway just down a few folks steps down towards the elevators. And there will be information about our church there and also persons to tell you more about our church as you would like. We also, if you are a first-time guest, have a gift for you. This is a Tervis-type tumbler that has the church logo on it, and we would be happy for you to have one. There's no strings attached. We just want you to know that we appreciate you being here, and there's also information about the church inside of that item. We especially want to also ask you to find the fellowship pad that you'll find in the seat closest to the center aisle, that you'll fill out the information that is requested there. And once the pad has gotten to the outside of your row, if you'll pass it back, it'll give chance for folks to look at who you are and your name and be able to call you by name as a part of their time here together and the opportunity to join in fellowship. You'll notice that we're a little short of in our chancel area. The choir is taking the month of July off, and so we need for you to sing lustfully today as we do that, that you have enthusiasm as you bring your song in prayer. We especially want to also remind you this week is the 4th of July parade. We have an entry, as always, in the parade. How many of you saw the parade float from last year on the front page of the crier this week? Yeah, that was a great bit of publicity for our church, and we'll have another float. Johnny and Ann Stone have once again worked with us to put together a team of folks. The float has been built. A few minor touches still to be done, but we will be in the parade, so please look for us and clap loudly when our float comes by. Also, the Boy Scouts are selling tickets to the barbecue, which is a part of the ministry that they have following the parade, and so you'll have a chance to find one of the Boy Scouts outside to buy your ticket so that you might participate and support them in their endeavors.
As we come to a time of prayer, I invite you to find the concerns and celebrations listed on page 7 of your bulletin. This morning, we extend our Christian sympathy to Sharon and Carrie Ward on the death of her father, John Morris, grandfather of Nathan and Lindsay. And to Theo and Doug Messerly on the death of Theo's mother, Audrey Putney. And to the list of prayer concerns, we add the names of Mina Kirkley, Estella Witter, and Gail Yarborough. And now let us go to God in a time of prayer. Holy God, whose Spirit moved over the waters at the dawn of creation, hear our prayers for all who thirst this day. We pray for those who are spiritually thirsty, who long to know your presence, but don't know where to find you. We pray for those who are alone and without hope, those who long to feel needed and loved, those who are searching for meaning and purpose. Loving God, we pray for those who are weeping, the sad, the depressed, and the anxious. We hope in the promise that you will wipe every tear from our eyes. We pray for those who are grieving the death of a loved one or friend, and we hope in the promise that death and mourning will be no more. We pray for those who are in pain, suffering from illness either physically or mentally, and we hope in the promise that crying and pain will be no more. We pray for those who are thirsty for truth, love, and grace. Those who seek you, O God, and your life with earnest hearts. We hope in the promise that you will give water to the thirsty without cost from the spring of the water of life. And on this weekend, before we celebrate the independence of our country, we pray for our leaders, O God, that they may make decisions and provide leadership that seeks to unite us rather than to divide us. We pray that our leaders would seek your guidance in all that they do and that they would govern in such a way that they are mindful of their actions and the consequences of those actions. We especially pray this day, O God, for the children who have been separated from their families, whether it was done at our border or whether those children were sent to our country alone in search of asylum. We pray for their safety and security, and that they may be swiftly reunited with their families. Lord, your words are trustworthy and true. You are the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. You are our God, and we are your sons and daughters, and we are thankful. We pray all this in the powerful and hopeful name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Last night I lay a-sleeping, there came a dream so fair. I stood in old Jerusalem beside the temple there. I heard the children singing, and ever as they sang, methought the voice of angels from heaven answer rang. Methought the voice of angels from heaven answer rang. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, lift up your gates and see. When I thought my dream was changed, the streets no longer rang. Hushed were the glad hosannas the little children sang. The sun grew dark with mystery, the morn was cold and chill, as the shadow of a cross arose upon a lonely hill. As the shadow of a cross arose upon a lonely hill. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, hark how the angels sing. Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna to your King. And once again the scene was changed, new earth there seemed to be. I saw the holy city beside the tideless sea. The light of God was on its streets, the gates were open wide, and all who would might enter, and no one was denied. No need of moon or stars by night, or sun to shine by day. It was the new Jerusalem that would not pass away. It was
we come to the reading of God's Word, I invite you to stand as you are able. Our scripture this morning comes from the book of Revelation, the 21st chapter, verses 1 through 7, and you may follow along with the text printed on your insert. Listen now for the Word of God. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the former heaven and the former earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, made ready as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. I heard a loud voice from the throne say, "Look, God's dwelling is here with humankind. He will dwell with them and they will be his peoples. God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. There will be no mourning, crying, or pain anymore, for the former things have passed away." Then the one seated on the throne said, "Look, I'm making all things new." He also said, "Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true." Then he said to me, "All is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will freely give water from the life-giving spring. Those who emerge victorious will inherit these things. I will be their God, and they will be my sons and daughters. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Will you bow with me for just a moment of prayer? Our gracious and loving God, now may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts together be acceptable to you. O Lord, our strength and our everlasting Redeemer. Amen. A couple of times each year I try to go away for 4 or 5 days to do some sermon planning for the church. I like to try and plan out the sermons for somewhere between 6 to 12 months. I'd like to do it for about 18 months, but I've never quite gotten that far before. And I usually try, when I do this, to go away to the mountains or to the beach or someplace like that where I can just kind of relax and you know, clear my mind of all the clutter and pray and study and just let there be a free flow of ideas into my mind. Now, I think some of the staff sometimes thinks that I try to do this in order to get an extra week or two of vacation. But that's not really true. Because everything we do in worship, everything we've done this morning in worship, sort of flows out of the plan that we put in place for the year. The scripture we read, the sermons that are preached, the music that is chosen, the hymns that we sing, even the prayers that we pray often come directly out of this preaching plan. And actually, near the end of this month, I'll be doing that once again. But earlier this year, I did this. I think it was in February, and while I was away on that retreat, I started thinking about some of the questions that people have asked me. Questions like, is God really good all the time? Is Satan real? Does God still heal today? And as you know, that has been, those questions have been the basis of the series of sermons that we've been in over the last several weeks. And this morning we're coming to the conclusion of that series of sermons by looking at the subject, is heaven real? And just as I'm sure you've noticed with some of the other sermons, if you've been here in worship over the last several weeks, then you know that our answer to that question is really a matter of faith. Just as you can't prove that God is good all the time or that Satan is real or that God still heals today, just as those things are matters of faith, our answer to the question of is heaven real is a matter of faith. And what I mean by that is that you can't prove that heaven is real. No one has gone to heaven and come back with physical evidence of the reality of heaven. There is no law, like the law of relativity, that you can point to that can prove that heaven is real. Whether or not you believe in heaven is simply a matter of faith. Now that said, there are some signs of the reality of heaven. For example, there is that longing that is buried deep within each one of us for a new and a better world. One scholar put it this way, there is no human soul steeped in the human condition that has not at a point yearned for a radically new world. Whether it's Karl Marx sketching out what he believed was the ideal economic state, or John Lennon inviting us to imagine a peaceful world, the hope is always there for this different and better world. And where might this longing come from? If not from the home from which we came and from the home to which God promises that we will one day return. There are also those moments, you've had them, I've had them, those moments when heaven itself seems to break into the very reality of our lives. Maybe it happened one day when you were standing before a mountain range and you just felt the inspiration of the Holy Spirit upon you and you knew that there was something more, or maybe it's a piece of music that touched your very heart and brought you to the point of tears. By the way, Hugh really did do a great job, didn't he? Wasn't that wonderful? Maybe it's when you held your granddaughter or your grandson or your child in your arms and you just somehow knew that heaven is real. We've all had these moments. I was thinking about that this week and I recalled one of those moments. It happened a few years ago. It happened when I sunk a 6-foot putt for a birdie on the 8th hole of Augusta National. In that moment, I wasn't wondering if heaven was real. A very part of heaven itself had just broken into my... And then there are the people who seem to have paid a visit to heaven and then have come back to tell us about their experience. You've heard some of those stories. Before her death, my mother told me of her story. She was in the intensive care unit of the hospital struggling with congestive heart failure. And she was right at the edge of life and death. The doctor said that I could stay in the intensive care room with her. Normally they don't do that, as you know, but they said I could stay in there. But she needed quiet, and so I brought some books in, and most of the time I just read, and we were silent. But every now and then we would have some conversation, and I remember one time turning to her, and I asked her, I said, "Mom, are you afraid to die?" And she smiled at me, and she said, "No, I'm not afraid to die." And then she went on to describe for me the kind of stories that I'm sure some of you have heard. She talked about seeing that bright light. She talked about a time, I was too young to remember it, and she'd never told me about it. This was the first time. And she had been on the operating table, and she had died, and the doctors had to bring her back. And she told of seeing that bright light and of having that peace that she had never known before. My mother actually lived 7 more years after that hospital stay. And I am told, I was not there when she died, but I was told that when she died with a smile on her face. Some of you will immediately recognize the name of Elizabeth Kubler-Ross. Elizabeth Kubler-Ross was a Swiss-American psychiatrist that back in the late 1960s did a groundbreaking study that became the turning point for those scientists who work in this area. She did a study with terminally ill patients, and she cataloged the stages of death and dying. And she wrote her book on death and dying. She was a scientist, and for almost all of her life, she believed that when the body ceased to exist, life itself ceased. A few years ago, much later after that original study, she did another study, an exhaustive study. She interviewed thousands of patients who had had life after life experiences, and she chronicled some of those experiences in her book on life after death. And in it, she noted how not a single patient that she had talked to who had had a life after life experience was ever again afraid to die, and it changed her life. She came to understand or to feel that just because the body ceases to exist, life itself continues to go on. Is heaven real? What do you think? In our lesson this morning, we read the witness of John the Revelator. John, you may recall, was exiled to the island of Patmos, where he wrote the book of Revelation. And the book of Revelation is really a book about good and evil. But John deals with that whole question of good and evil by pointing to the ultimate climax of history. And our lesson is a portion of that picture, that vision that was given to John of what things would be like when everything was brought into fulfillment. Our lesson was just a small portion of it. It actually goes on for two chapters, but in that it was just this picture. It's a grand and a glorious vision. So much so that if you're not careful, you're tempted to just look over the details of the vision that he gives. But it's important not to do that. It's important to pay very close attention to those details. For example, if you look very carefully, you will discover that much of the new heaven that he describes not in terms of what is there, but in terms of what is not there. Right at the very beginning, he starts out by telling us, and the sea was no more. Now, for those of you who are about to go to the beach, you may be wondering why he says that. But in biblical language, the sea was synonymous with chaos. It was the abode of the Leviathan, the dragon, who was continually trying to upset and do away with the goodness of God's creation. You remember when Jesus and the disciples were out on the Sea of Galilee in a boat, and all of a sudden a storm came up, and the wind and the waves were about to overwhelm that boat. You remember what Jesus did? What did he do? Well, he walked on water, but that's not the story I'm talking about. He got up and he said, "Peace, be still," right? And the scholars tell us that was not just a quiet peace, be still, and everything was calm. They tell us that the language he used was the language of exorcism. John says, the sea, the chaos will be no more. Anybody have chaos in their life? He tells us that there will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain anymore. The day that Kathy prayed about in her prayer, where that would be true, he says, will one day happen. And then later in that chapter, at the very end of the 21st chapter, he goes on to say that there will be nothing unclean, nothing vile, nothing deceitful. What's John doing here? John is inviting us to look at the world in which we live with all of its brokenness and pain and strife and sorrow and heartbreak. And he's inviting us to imagine a place where none of that exists. Can you do that for just a moment? Can you imagine a place where there will be no more terminal illness, no more chemotherapy, no more radiation treatments? Can you imagine a place where there will be no more violence, no more school shootings, no more tragedies like the Capital Gazette? Doesn't that break your heart every time you hear of something like that? Can you imagine a place where there will be no more illegal drugs or human trafficking or children who are separated from their parents for whatever the reason is? Can you imagine a place where there will be no more deceit, no more con games, no more spin? Can you imagine a place where there will be no more put downs and people will act civilly to one another? Well, the moment, John says, that you can begin to imagine that, then you're going to begin to get a glimpse, just a glimpse, but a glimpse of what heaven is like. He tells us that it will be a place where there will be no temple. Now, I don't know about you, but I kind of find that interesting. I mean, of all of the places that you would expect to see a sanctuary, wouldn't that place be in heaven? Why? Why is there no temple, or why is there no sanctuary there? because it will not be needed. As Dr. Fred Craddock once put it, every brook will be a baptistry. Every star will be a chandelier. Every stone will be an altar. Every table will be a table of the Lord. And every person will be a brother or a sister in Christ. Heaven, says John, will be so full of the presence of God that every moment, every single moment, will be full of worship and praise. One of the things he tells us that will be there is that the population will consist of people of all the nations of the world. Now think about that just for a moment. That means that there will be no them and us, only us. There will be no Jews and Arabs, only us. There will be no Russians and Americans, only us. There will be no gays and straights, only us. There will be no whites or blacks or Asians or Hispanics, only us. There will be no Republicans and Democrats. Well, I'm not so sure about that one. That's a tough one. It's a magnificent vision, isn't it? I mean, what's not to like about this vision of heaven? But I don't know. This week I've been thinking a little bit about that. And it occurred to me that given this vision of heaven, there may be some of us who might find ourselves feeling just a little bit uncomfortable. And here's what I mean by that. If a person has spent an entire lifetime hedging on the truth, how's that person going to feel in a place where there is no deceit? If a person has spent a lifetime with a heart of resentment towards a person or towards a group of people, how's that person going to feel in a place where it is ruled by love and every person is a brother or a sister? If a person has spent a lifetime trying to avoid church, or if they had to go to church, if they have spent a lifetime wishing they could be somebody someplace else, how are they going to feel when every moment is either 8:45 or 11:05 on Sunday morning? If a person has spent a lifetime consumed with materialism, always wanting more, always thinking that life is just around the corner. If I can just get more, if I can just have more, if I can have bigger and better, and how's that person going to feel in a place where none of it matters? See what I mean? It's a mix, isn't it? And I will tell you that I know that in my life there are things right now that will not fit well in heaven. I'd like to believe that I'm further along today than I was 20 years ago, 10 years ago, 5 years ago. But there is no one in this room, no one anywhere really, other than possibly my wife, who is aware of the distance between the intent of the person I want to be and the reality of who I am. And my hunch is that most of you are that way as well. But I'm not worried. And here's why. In the words of the Apostle Paul, I believe that the one who began a good work in us will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. Is heaven real? I believe it is. But the question that is important for you is, what do you believe? And the more important question for you is when that day actually comes. When you enter the pearly gates and you begin to unpack all of your belongings, will you have matured enough in your faith to where you will be able to sit down in that chair and say, ah, home at last. Home at last. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
You will find the liturgy for the sacrament of Holy Communion in your bulletin this morning. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the
Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, God Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and you spoke to us through the prophets. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, drink from this, all of you. For this is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Because there is one loaf, we, even though we are many, are one body, for we partake of the one loaf. The cup over which we give thanks is a sharing in the blood of Christ. At this time, I want to invite those who are to help serve the sacrament to come forward. And as they come, a few words of instruction are in order. First of all, you don't need to be a member of this church to receive the sacrament. All are invited. In the United Methodist Church, we have an open communion table. What is expected is that when you come, that you, after you have received this sacrament, after you have feasted at the table, you will intend to lead a new life following the commandments of God, and that you will do all in your power to be in harmony with your neighbors. We will have a gluten-free station. It'll be the center station, so if you desire gluten-free bread, please come to the center aisle. And we will be receiving the sacrament by way of intinction. Let me invite you to simply take your hands and put them in the shape of a cross. As you come, you will receive the bread, and then you will simply dip it in the cup, and we will receive the sacrament that way. There will be four stations. They will all be here at the front, and you're invited to come. Kathy, this is the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, broken again.